Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, sitting in for Mike Papantonio this week. Coming up on today's show, we'll take a look at the midterm election results and find out what it means for the future of both major political parties. We'll tell you what banks are really doing with your money when you make a deposit, and we'll explain why medical malpractice lawsuit caps are having absolutely no effect on healthcare costs. We have all that and more coming up, so get ready. You've stepped into the Ring of Fire.
You can't change Washington from the inside. You can only change it from the outside.
Grand jury secrecy rules.
For political gain.
The press can find out.
That has nothing to do with politics, but go ahead.
It wouldn't bother me.
Oops.
Democrats are hanging their heads after this past week's midterm elections, and they should. There shouldn't have been any reason for the Democratic Party to lose ground in this election, but they did. In some races, they were actually defeated by candidates who make Forrest Gump look like a Rhodes Scholar. The Democratic Party was defeated by anti-science, anti-LGBT, anti-women, anti-minority, and anti-government candidates in races all over the country. The next 2 years are looking pretty bleak at this point. Or are they? Would things really be any different if the Democrats had won a majority in both houses of Congress? Honestly, I don't think so. There's no denying that Republicans have made obstruction their brand during the Obama years. They've blocked judicial appointments, cabinet appointments, infrastructure bills, job bills, immigration bills, and everything else that this country desperately needs. They even shut down the federal government a year ago because they didn't get their way. These are the people that the Democratic Party just lost to in the midterms. That's pretty sad. But again, I don't think it matters which party controls what. Let me take you back to the years of 2009 and 2010. During those 2 years, Democrats controlled the White House, the Senate, and the House of Representatives. What do we have to show for those 2 years of control? A watered-down healthcare bill that, when you really drill down into it, is basically a giveaway to the insurance and pharmaceutical industries. We didn't get universal healthcare like we needed. We didn't get Wall Street accountability like we needed. We didn't get the much-needed minimum wage increase. We didn't get infrastructure bills or really anything for the party to be proud of. So let me ask again, does it really matter which party controls the House and Senate? I don't think so. Of course, you could argue that Republican obstruction prevented those much-needed measures, and to an extent, you'd be correct. But, and this is the most important thing to remember here, the Democrats never fought back. They never got angry. They didn't take to the airwaves to make sure that every single American voter understood that the Democrats were trying to give the public what they desperately needed, but the Republicans were blocking each and every reform measure. They didn't do any of that. So in spite of the obstruction, these failures are the fault of the Democratic Party. This year's electoral failures are also the Democrats' fault. A great example of a Democratic failure is the prevalence of new restrictive voting laws. Since the 2008 election of President Obama, 22 states have enacted new voting laws that make it more difficult for minorities to vote. And this isn't a coincidence. These new laws were a direct result of Obama's election. Old, decrepit white guys were appalled that the nation elected an African-American president, and minority voters, in the eyes of those aging racist folks, were to blame. So they hopped on board with the GOP's efforts to cut down on the rights of the American people. The Republicans managed to play on the fears of a generation that looks back and remembers fondly the days of segregation. These people were born into a racist society, brought up believing that it was okay, and some of them never grew out of that mindset. Those are the people that the Republicans recruited to sell their voting restrictions, and it worked. And where was the Democratic backlash? The public was angry, a few politicians were angry, and progressive organizations were angry. But the public's anger and activism did not inspire any leadership from Washington, D.C. And that's why thousands of eligible voters were turned away from the polls in this year's election. The policies were Republican, but the failure to do anything about it, once again, hangs around the necks of the Democrats. The Democratic Party has to be willing to accept blame here. If they don't accept the blame, then they don't learn anything. They don't change, They don't work to get better. Instead, they're going to blame Republicans. They're going to blame low voter turnout or whatever. And then they do the same things, make the same mistakes in the next elections. Accepting part of the blame is part of the growing process. Look at what you did wrong and get better. That's a natural part of life. It's a natural part of the learning process. And this really is a teachable moment for Democrats. The lion's share of the blame in this year's election losses goes to the corporatist wing of the Democratic Party, the Hillary Clinton wing. They believe that they can talk like populists on the campaign trail and act like Republicans once they get elected. That was never a winning strategy, and it will never be a winning strategy. If you talk about wages and jobs and the environment during a stump speech, we, the voters, expect you to deliver when we put you into office. Do you know why populists are gravitating towards people like Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders? Because they don't talk in typical politician fashion. They don't skirt issues because they're afraid to take a stand for fear they'll alienate a voter or two. They're honest, open, candid, and straightforward. They take on issues like Wall Street crimes or living wages, not because it'll garner them a few more votes, but because they legitimately believe in those things. The Democratic Party could learn something from those two. But instead, we're still stuck in this Clinton-era time warp. Do you realize that in the 2016 election, it could actually be Clinton versus Bush, just like in 1992? We need to abandon political nepotism. We have to move on from the failed ideas of the past and embrace candidates who represent new generations of Americans. Generations that are coming of age with tens of thousands of dollars in student loan debt. Generations that are facing a job market that won't let them in. Generations that are begging the old guard to protect our environment so that we have a habitable planet 20 years from now. It is time to say goodbye to the Clinton wing of the Democratic Party, which also happens to be the corporate wing of the party. American democracy was not built to serve special interests. It was built to give formerly repressed people a say in how their country is run, and that is something that I think we have all forgotten about. Like I said, this is a teachable moment for both the Democratic Party and American voters. The decision on whether or not to take that lesson and apply it now rests with all of us. I, for one, will not waste this opportunity, and I sincerely hope that you don't either. These next 2 years will be tough. But we know where we can improve. We have to improve the Democratic base. We have to unite the different movements within the progressive community. Unions have to stand up for environmentalists, and the pro-choice movement needs to speak out on behalf of voting rights groups. No single issue is bigger than all of the issues, and without unity among these groups, there will never be victory. From defeat comes knowledge. And while the next few years will be rough, if we take the lessons we've learned from this year's elections, we can move forward as a unified movement that knows how to win and that will deliver what they promise. We'll be right back.
We perpetuate a culture of crime all the way from Wall Street right down to the Main Street in our hometowns.
It's worse than it has been since FDR took control of the problem and said we can't count on industry taking care of the American labor.
They probably have already engaged in some type of criminal cover-up.
And the law prohibits the government from even doing anything about it.
Catch America's lawyer Mike Papantonio on YouTube at youtube.com/goleftTV. A few months ago, Mike Papantonio spoke with author C.J. Werleman about the issue of American voters being too stupid for their own good. It's a very interesting piece, and given this week's midterm election results, I think it's very relevant. So let's revisit that interview now.
The average American, unfortunately, there's some problems out there with what they know and understand. The average American, for most people, can't even name a single Supreme Court justice. They think to this day that Saddam Hussein was involved in 9/11, and too many voters still think that they might run into Bigfoot on their way to the polls. It's some scary stuff. I have author C.J. Werleman with me to tell us why this is happening, and more importantly, why it's the problem. It's pretty obvious about why it's a problem, but CJ's a great, great columnist, writes for Alternet and Salon. He's the author of the new book, Crucifying America, The Unholy Alliance Between the Christian Right and Wall Street. Just an all-around, really smart, smart person. CJ, great job on this article. The Americans are dangerously politically ignorant. You're unequivocal about it, aren't you?
Yeah, well, thanks, Mike, and thanks for the very, very kind kind introduction. Happy to be on your show. But, mate, yeah, I think what I touched on in this piece is something, as you alluded to, is very scary. That 91% of Americans can't name the current Chief Justice is alarming, and especially alarming considering the number of high-profile cases that we've had in the United States just in the last few years, everything from the Affordable Care Act to same-sex marriage and campaign finance laws. These are polarizing issues which have touched on the lives of most Americans, and yet nobody knows who's at the helm when it comes to deciding these cases.
I like the way you started your article, CJ. You started your article talks about David Bratt from Virginia, and he gets up and just begins with this diatribe about how the framers of the Constitution absolutely wanted the Constitution to be based on Christian roots. I mean, that was that's what he was out there saying. Judeo-Christian roots is where all this came from, and that they acted on behalf of God to write the Constitution. And nobody questioned him about it. I mean, that's what's remarkable. Journalists, gone to school to be journalists, nobody asked the question, well, what the hell are you talking about?
Yeah, well, I mean, what he said is no different, really, to almost what is the Republican Party's platform. If you look at their platform, they believe that that's how the Constitution was written. They believe it was handed down by God, and what it doesn't make him the exception to the rule. I mean, he is only echoing what people like Sarah Palin to Ted Cruz will mutter in any public debate when it comes to the origins or the genesis of the Constitution.
Well, I mean, but that to me was a great framework to understanding that the overall incredible majority would really tell you that that where it comes to the framers of the Constitution, their whole intent was to make sure that they fashioned something consistent with Christianity, something consistent with the Old Testament and New Testament. Nothing was further from the truth. But it's worse than that. I mean, there's this collective ignorance that really seems to pervade. It's a civic illiteracy almost, as I think you've described it. How bad, if you were to quantify, how bad is it? Where would you begin?
I think a great illustration of how bad it is the Affordable Care Act. Let's take Kentucky for instance. Now, if 25% of residents, when residents of Kentucky are asked how do they feel if they have a positive or a favorable view of the Affordable Care Act, only 25% will respond in favor. But if they're asked how do they view about Connect, which is the state exchange for the Affordable Care Act, more than half respond positively. Now, bearing in mind that both, the Connect is the state exchange for Obamacare. Now, that illiteracy in not understanding the difference and not understanding it as one and the same thing allows someone like Mitch McConnell to get away with saying, I still want to go ahead and repeal Obamacare, but we can keep Connect. I mean, as one journalist said, that's like, the Miami Heat saying, we're going to trade the LeBron James, but we're going to keep his jump shot.
Well, it's even crazier. In your article, you talk about 42% of Americans think that the Constitution explicitly, the U.S. Constitution explicitly states that the first language to be used in the United States is English. I haven't seen that. Taken many constitutional law courses, haven't seen it. 25% believe that Christianity was established in the Constitution. Now, verify that I'm not making that up.
No, that was a poll taken by the National Constitution Center in 2007. So that poll was taken from a wide sample across the entire breadth of the United States. So I don't think this poll is something that's in isolation. I think this is truly reflected not only by this poll, but anytime you turn on Fox News or any part of the right-wing echo chamber, you will hear right-wing Republican politicians echo sentiments which drive to those points. And like you mentioned earlier, the media never calls them out. I mean, I think in what I said at the end of the piece is the media is part of the problem, and the mainstream media, because, you know, there's nauseating drive to be impartial at all costs, you know, and the conflating of opinion with fact allows, you know, people to get away with saying, you know, stupid stuff.
In other words, if you have Republicans come up and say there's no such thing as gravity, and the Democrats say, well, there is gravity, CNN would put you on the air in a debate of whether or not gravity exists, just like we're seeing with virtually everything right now.
And then CNN stands back and says, look, Democrats and Republicans are fighting again.
Well, and the commentator may even say, you know, people disagree. That's how crazy. People disagree. Gravity is real. But you see, where does that – I was a journalism major back at University of Florida. And, that, of course, that was back in, mid-70s, early 80s. And the what we were taught then was, yeah, you got to tell the story on both sides, but you don't buy into stupid. It's not your role as a journalist to buy in and then promulgate stupid. That is the new standard in journalism now. And really, CJ, the people that are critical of journalism these days say that even the typical journalist coming out of school doesn't have the fundamental education to understand complex issues themselves. What's your take on that?
Yeah, well, I think it's all the continued dumbing down of society. I mean, the media was never like that, and you mentioned that. Today... stupid gets to propagate because it's never challenged. I mean, you only have to look at that in the debate when it comes to climate change. Now, climate change in this country is presented as a partisan, political partisan issue, whereas in the rest of the Western world, it's just treated as fact. And anybody comes on the media and says this is, you know, a liberal conspiracy to make Al Gore rich, is quickly shut down out of the debate. But here, when you've got 97.9% of the scientific community saying climate change is happening and it's man-made and it's happening right now, but you have the Republican Party or somebody who's paid by the Koch brothers to get on the media and say it's just a liberal hoax, then it's presented, that opinion is presented as a fact. And that's, coming back to this piece again with David Bratz, he's able to say what he said about the Constitution, and that's not challenged. Fact, you know, opinion isn't challenged and facts are left, uncovered.
Well, part of the problem, we're talking about media, part of the problem here is it's a corporate media, you see. And you have the corporation that has the advertiser or the political entity that puts pressure on them to do something as stupid as saying, well, look, the Republicans don't believe in such things as gravity. The Democrats do. So let's put them on Sunday talk shows and let's let them talk about something. And the person watching it says, well, my God, you know, there must be some question about gravity. All these years I thought there was gravity, but maybe there's not, because the commentator on CNN says it's an issue to be determined. You know, isn't there another side? And I love the way you nail this, CJ. I love this. I'm kind of a fan of Brecht also, and you talk about Bertolt Brecht, 20th century German playwright. He wrote this great piece about the need for avoiding the political illiterate. You know, why must we do that? And he says in there that it's interesting that the political illiterate is the first one to stand up and crow like a rooster and beat on their chest and say, well, it's not important to me because I hate politics. You know, I thought that was interesting, because if you really drill down, the person who hates politics doesn't pay attention is in big trouble, aren't they?
Oh, absolutely. And to finish that quote from Brecht, he says, you know, the imbecile doesn't know that from his political ignorance is born the prostitute, the abandoned child, and the worst seed of all, the bad politician.
Years ago, Republican operatives got together to discuss their options for defunding the Democratic Party. Their idea was to attack trial lawyers who, at the time, were the single largest donors to the Democrats. That's where the idea of tort reform was born, and Republicans have sold the idea to the American people by claiming that it would reduce health care costs. Nothing could be further from the truth, and the numbers prove it. I have attorney Howard Nations with me to talk about this. Howard, I know we've talked a lot about medical malpractice, tort reform, things like that on the show before, but it is a very important topic. It's an important topic that I don't think a lot of people realize how bad this problem has really gotten in the United States. Lay it out for us. How bad is it?
Let me give you this analogy, Farron. Suppose Brian Williams went on TV tonight and said, 268 people were killed today in an air crash as a result of negligence of the airline. And then tomorrow he came in with another 268 being killed. And then he did that every day for a week, and then for a month. And every day for a year, 268 people were killed as a result of negligence of the airline, until 440,000 people had been killed in 1 year. Then, what would the political response be, aside from blaming it on Obama?
We'd shut down airports, airlines. We'd have a full-scale investigation. They, I would assume, would try to figure out, you know, what is going on. We're killing so many people every day.
Suppose the only political response was that they passed legislation to put a cap on the recovery of the victims for damages, or to eliminate the right for recovery of damages completely. That's what's happened. That's the status of medical malpractice today. The fact is, medical malpractice after heart attack and cancer is the third leading cause of deaths in America. Preventable medical errors in hospitals specifically. Now, listen to where the statistics come from on this. In 1999, the Institute of Medicine found that there were 98,000 people a year dying, 268 a day, 15 years ago. In 2010, the Inspector General of Health and Human Services found that there are 180,000 Medicare patients alone, Medicare alone, dying each year from preventable medical errors in hospitals. Now, last month, in the Journal of Patient Safety, there's a new finding that 440,000, up to 440,000, that's 1,205 people per day, of preventable deaths are occurring in hospitals. If it were from any other cause, it would be epidemic proportions. It would be a major crisis. Look where we are today from one death from Ebola in this country.
And there were obviously some hospital errors that took place with that one as well, that, you know, those errors have made it onto the news. You know, how did this nurse break protocol? But when you have doctors out there who, out of nothing more than sheer negligence, killing over 1,200 people a day, close to 500,000 people a year, I mean, those numbers are getting up there, you know, not quite as bad, but, you know, I mean, those are, you know, tobacco numbers. Those are, you know, things that we took action on. And as you pointed out there, the only action, the only thing that Congress has done, that state legislatures have done, have said, okay, this is a problem, so how do we address it? Let's go after the trial lawyers. That's what
exactly
they've done.
Well, let me tell you about that death from Ebola in Dallas. Ordinary negligence by people sending him home, missing the diagnosis, that sort of thing, there is no recovery for that in Texas as a result of tort reform. There is no cause of action. Doctors in medical, in emergency rooms, nurses in emergency rooms, hospital protocols in emergency rooms, it's okay to kill people by ordinary negligence. In order to recover, you would have to show gross negligence for emergency care, which means that they knew that this was dangerous, they knew it could occur, but they went ahead and did it anyway. Doctors are basically above the law in Texas. It's as a result of Texas being such an egregious state in protecting the people who are killing 440,000 people a year. One of the things they did was place a cap on damages of victims. The RAND study, which was reported in the New England Journal of Medicine, the most prestigious medical journal in America, evaluated Texas, Georgia, and South Carolina. And they were trying to assess the claim that defensive medicine by doctors is what's escalating the cost of medical care in the United States. So they reviewed 3 million medical records. They reviewed three metrics, which is frequency of imaging studies, the rate of patient admission post-ER, and the total charges for ER. They compared it to states with no caps on damages, and they found there was no difference. In other words, if caps on damages were effective, you would expect a reduction in those three categories. There was no reduction. Another RAND study said that the AMA itself said that defensive orders account for only 2.9% of the cost, most of which is additional days in the hospital.
And these are, you know, those talking points. That's how they sold this concept of tort reform, of malpractice caps, to the American people. They went out there and they said, look, understand your healthcare costs are through the roof. We enact tort reform, they're going to go down. Listen, doctors are leaving your state because they're getting sued for malpractice every other day. They're going to leave your state. You're not going to have a doctor. People said, yes, we need tort reform. They said doctors will be able to charge less money because their malpractice premiums are going to drop because they don't have to worry about these, you know, quote unquote, frivolous lawsuits. And people said, yes, that's great. We're all behind it. And as you just pointed out, none of that happened. In fact, in most cases, it's quite opposite. I mean, premiums have either stayed the same or gone up while coverage has decreased. I know you know about that all too well, don't you?
Well, as a matter of fact, I do. I've looked at this from all three perspectives, Farron. I began my career 48 years ago defending hospitals and doctors and nurses in medical malpractice cases. In 1971, I switched over to the plaintiff's side, began prosecuting malpractice cases. In 1973, my law partner and I formed our own insurance company, writing medical malpractice insurance coverage. We got it going in 38 states and sold the company. So I viewed this from the viewpoint of a plaintiff's lawyer prosecuting cases, a defense lawyer defending cases, and the owner of an insurance company seeing their perspective. And I tell you, it's just totally outrageous what has occurred here. The political response to, even from the 99 study of 98,000 people a year dying, the political response has been nothing addressing the cause of those 98,000 deaths per year. The political response has been an attack on the Seventh Amendment. You know, the far right wing think there are only two amendments to the Constitution. They're attacking the right to trial by jury. The Chamber of Commerce, ALEC, the American Tort Reform Association committed a major fear-based fraud on the American public by taking the position that eliminating malpractice cases will eliminate the high cost of medical care. They're political lapdogs. You got to place blame where it's due. Mostly Republicans have passed legislation which slammed the courtroom doors for the victims of the epidemics of medical errors.
And you have to ask yourself, why are they doing this? Why does it matter to them? Well, one thing I've written about in our Trial Lawyer magazine since the very first issue, in fact, it was the very first story we ever ran, was the fact that many years ago, back, I believe, in the early 80s, you had these groups, you had the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, and several other think tanks, and even Karl Rove back when he was in Texas, they got together and they said, how can we take out the Democratic Party? We need to take out their money. And at the time, you know, this was pre-Citizens United, the major funder for the Democratic Party was always the trial lawyers associations. Trial lawyers knew that these were the guys that want to go in there and they want to strengthen protections. In fact, strengthen protections to the point that it may, you know, you may not have as many lawsuits to bring. But they knew it was for the good of the people. But Republicans got together and they said, we've got to take them out. We've got to take out the trial lawyers. And this is where the entire idea of tort reform came from. And you're right there in Texas. And that's really where this was born, out of Karl Rove and the Chamber of Commerce.
Well, Karl Rove has a very clear understanding of the power of fear. And the mantra of the Republican Party, if you think back over it for the last 30 years, since Karl Rove has had a substantial voice in it, It's all been fear tactics. You mentioned doctors leaving the state. In Texas, they got patients to vote against their own self-interest. That is, to vote away their rights to prosecute medical malpractice cases by threatening that, especially in small communities, you're not going to have a gynecologist, you're not going to have an obstetrician to deliver and care for your child. You're going to have to go hundreds of miles because the doctors are going to leave your city, doctors are going to leave the states if you don't pass this tort reform. And it worked. And I asked patients over and over and over, people who came to me with malpractice cases after this happened, and I'd say, well, you know, yes, you have negligence in your case, but you have no basis for recovery. A little thing called tort reform. Did you ever hear about tort reform? Oh, yeah, I voted for that. But that was to stop frivolous lawsuits. That doesn't apply to my case. That's what everybody says. No, that doesn't apply. The fact of the matter is it was a huge fraud. It applies to all cases, and the bigger the case, the more substantial the damages, the more it applies. But this whole thing about doctors leaving the state, Houston has the world's largest medical center. We are insourcing doctors from India, nurses from Nigeria. The fact is the only thing the doctors are leaving is that medical care in hospitals in Texas has gotten so bad now that the hospitals don't have to be concerned about being sued for their negligent acts, that doctors are leaving the hospitals. We see all sorts of new hospitals cropping up around Houston and around Texas where doctors are leaving and forming their own hospitals because they don't want to be under the practice in medicine under the auspices of the hospital corporations, the corporate America that now owns the hospitals in this country.
And, you know, I want to dispel another quick talking point, you know, that we've heard out of the Chamber of Commerce and these Republicans is that, you know, oh, well, we're just trying to put a stop to the greedy trial lawyers. They want to be able to sue a doctor for $5 million, you know, just because of a small medical error. But again, that's also not the case. I mean, some of these medical malpractice cases, say, for example, you've put a cap on it. They cannot recover more than $250,000, which is one of the standard caps, places like California, Texas. Sometimes an attorney can spend well over $1 million of their own money, of their firm's money, you know, doing discovery and investigations and things of that nature. So if you're talking about an attorney who's spent $1 million of their money, the most they can recover for their client is $250,000, and they get their fees out of that. You could be looking, you know, an attorney out, you know, close to $1 million, and it's not about the money. It really isn't. You know, you don't do these medical malpractice claims to get rich quick, but it becomes a reason for attorneys to not take the cases because they can't devote the time to losing that much money. I mean, it's very unfortunate, but it does happen. I mean, we've spoken to attorneys over the years on Ring of Fire who've said, you know, I hate it that I have to, but I have had to, you know, decline medical malpractice cases because the caps are so high and my firm can't even afford to do the discovery.
Well, in Texas, it's not just about the caps. They have so many traps built in there. They put so many hurdles in that it's virtually impossible to win and keep a malpractice verdict. If you got $1 million verdict in Texas, the Republican appellate courts, which are just completely owned by the corporations in Texas, in America, the appellate courts would take away that verdict. And at the last resort, the Texas Supreme Court, which is completely in the pocket of the medical society, would hasn't ruled in favor of a plaintiff in 15 years. So the effect of it is, if you put up that $100,000, $200,000, $500,000 it costs to prosecute a case, you get a recovery, you don't keep it. So they basically have slammed the courthouse door. I have not handled a malpractice case in Texas since 2003, since September 1st, 2003, when the tort reform went into effect, because it's just beating your head against a wall to go in and try to get a big recovery for a client who really deserves it and needs it, and only to have it taken away by the Republican appellate courts. Let me tell you the effect of this political response of attacking the victims instead of the attacking the cause of these deaths. In 1999, the study showed that there were 98,000 people a year dying as a result of medical errors in hospitals. That's 268 a day. The politicians attack victims' rights. The politicians ignored the cause of death. The hospitals, which used to be caregivers, are no longer caregivers. Hospitals are now owned by corporations. They're now profit centers. They're insourcing cheaper workforce. They're cutting corners. They're cutting on care. They're cutting on staffing. And the result is that 15 years later, 98,000 deaths per year has now turned into 440,000 deaths per year. 268 deaths per day has turned into 1,205 deaths per day. Still, there's absolutely no actions by the politicians to go to the source to stop the malpractice, or at least reduce it. Doctors and hospitals have been placed above the law. The bad thing, Farron, is in addition, there are 35 million more people insured as a result of Obamacare, so the numbers will continue to increase. The report by Dr. John James, who's a toxicologist at NASA, found the 440,000. His methods have been verified by prominent safety researchers. This is interesting. The American hospital's response to the 440,000 figure is, we believe that the 98,000 figure is closer to accurate. In other words, the American Hospital Association itself is saying, we're only killing 268 people per day. But still with this, even with that admission, there's absolutely no action to stop this epidemic except to protect the corporate perpetrators and abolish the rights of the victims.
And something I think all the viewers here need to understand, need to get it in their heads, and they need to remember this, you know, next time they head to the polls, next time they hear these talking points, this medical malpractice is just the beginning. Once they get this, they're going to go after consumer protections and every other form of lawsuit in this country and take away all your rights. And Howard, I'm glad we have people like you out there fighting and telling this story to us. And thanks for being with us today.
Thanks a lot, Farron.
You know, we've spent a lot of time talking about the crimes of the big banks, and there's a good reason for that. Almost every American will be at the mercy of a bank for some point in their lives, whether it's trusting them to hold your checking account or seeking a loan for a house or a car. The banking industry is heavily involved with our day-to-day lives. The question is, what do we know about the banks, and what are they doing with our money? Joining me now to help answer that question is attorney Michael Burg. Michael, when we go and we put our money in a bank, you know, we assume it's almost like it's a wonderful life. When you think of, you know, they go, they put their money in and they come back and they say, well, where's our money? They say, well, your money's in his house. Your money's in his house. We loan the money out. We help people and everybody, the whole community wins. That used to be the concept of banking that we saw in the 40s and 50s. But that's not what's happening around there today, is it?
No, not at all. In fact, banks, once they repealed Glass-Steagall, banks are into everything, not just the community.
And, you know, this whole idea of loaning money, you know, creating something tangible for the economy, that's what we need banks to do. That's one of the reasons why we're not seeing as big of an economic recovery as we should be. We bailed out the banks. We gave them billions and billions, trillions of dollars almost, if you include all the tax breaks they get, and they're not loaning this money out. We give them our money in confidence and nothing. Where is the money going right now?
Well, it's interesting because these big banks, one of the things that's interesting is they're now trying to show greater profits for their shareholders. Again, Wall Street is running this. The big banks are in Wall Street. They're creating economic growth for the banks, but not for the little guy, not for the businessman, not for the small business, not even necessarily for the larger businesses, because what they don't want to do is they want deposits. They want the money coming in. They want you to give them their money. And they also want to borrow it from the Fed at a very, very low rate. These are the big banks. And most of all, they want to invest. They want to own buildings. They want to do these securitized products like we saw with the CDOs. They're interested in mass profit. They're not interested in giving money back to the community. What's unbelievable is that we have community banks. We have banks that are out there that really want to be part of the community, the smaller banks, but they can't borrow at the same rate that the big banks do. So their cost of funds are greater. They also can't potentially, because they don't have the size, to give depositors a greater rate of return. And so what happens is those small banks are being pushed out of existence by the major banks. The community banks also, many times, they're going to have, like here in Denver or in many other communities, they'll have 5 or 6 branches because they want to give service to the community. Those are expensive. There's an additional 1-2% that it costs to expand to have those. And so what we're seeing is banks are getting bigger profits. Banks are making more money. Banks are doing securitized products, which are dangerous to our economy in total, but they're not lending the money. And so when you say it's a wonderful life, those days are gone, except for one state in particular that's made a change.
Well, and you know, the big banks, these Wall Street banks, you know, the huge Bank of America, Chase Manhattan, Compass Bank, they have squeezed out the local community banks. You used to be able to go into a town, you know, drive down the main drag, and you would see, you know, maybe 2 or 3 little local banks, things you'd never heard of, but those were the local banks. And now you do the same thing. You drive down there, there's 4 Bank of America branches within 4 blocks of each other. They've squeezed out these little local banks. And as you pointed out, it's because these small banks can't get the same kind of special treatment. Not that that would be a bad thing for them, but they can't get this special treatment that a Bank of America can or that a Chase can, because they have armies of corporate lawyers and lobbyists who sit in Washington all day long and come up with ways to get into the halls of Congress and get what they want. Your little community bank can't do that, so they can't get these interest rates. They can't loan money to people at a lower rate. And so we're almost stuck. You know, we're stuck with these big behemoth banks who care more about gambling on Wall Street than they do about loaning money to a 20-year-old trying to buy a car at an 8% interest rate. I mean, that's kind of what I'm seeing here.
And it's very accurate. Farron, you're absolutely right. The other part that's not in there is these credit cards. The big banks, they're tied in with the airlines, they're tied in with cash back, and what they want to do is they want to get all your money. They don't want to have usury laws on credit cards. They can get you for 21%, 22%, and yet the small bank, they don't have the structure to give you a credit card. And if they do, it's hard to compete. So they're basically wiping out those community banks that we used to see in every community. They're wiping them out at all levels. And exactly what you said is they own Washington. They own the House. They own the Senate. They own the presidency. They're there to dictate to the American people that you don't have a choice. Either you're going to play by their rules, and their rules are strictly for them. And people who need money for small businesses, they can't get it. And so they have to figure out how they're going to survive.
And when you talk about them owning Washington, the real dirty part about Wall Street and these banks is that they have so much money. If you pull up the finance reports on where they're spending their money, it's almost even. They've got so much money, they buy both sides, so it doesn't matter who wins an election. It doesn't matter who the president is. They've paid off both sides. They win. I mean, that's like going to the roulette table and putting a dollar on every spot on the table. You win no matter what. And so that's exactly what's happened. And I want to touch back. You mentioned this is happening in all states but one. What's the exception there?
Well, North Dakota, they came up with a real system to try to get money back into the community. And it's really what you'd almost describe as a public bank. The state revenues are collected, and, you know, millions and millions of dollars, especially, you know, North Dakota is booming in the oil and gas business right now, so their revenues are way up. And what they're doing is they take that revenue and they're depositing it into community banks. Banks in North Dakota, not banks that are, you know, not the big banks, not Chase, not Bank of America, but in the community banks, giving the money back to the community. And what is happening is those community banks are now able to increase their average loan. So Joe down the street can go borrow to get a car. Their loans, if you compare them to other states, their average loans are double or triple the amount. But it's because of the funding that's been done by the state of North Dakota with their state banks. Not the federal banks, these are state banks. And so in essence, they've created their own system to put money back into the community. And that's an example that I think many states can follow to try to keep our community banks alive and give the small businesses an opportunity to borrow. Today, if you're a small business and you go into Chase or you go into Bank of America, more likely than not, they're gonna say to you, yeah, we can lend you that $50,000, but you got to put $50,000 into our bank. Well, that's, you know, on deposit or a security, or they're going to want to take all your business. They want to take everything there is to keep you in business. And that's just not the way it was, you know, back in the 50s or 60s, or even way back when we saw It's a Wonderful Life, where we had the Bailey bank and loan.
Yeah.
And that's what the community needs. That's what we need in our society.
And, you know, another big point there, too, is that we're looking at these little local community banks, and they do have to follow strict regulations, very strict compliance, and those are rules and laws that actually do not apply to banks like Bank of America and Chase. I hate to keep using the same ones, but it's the most popular. Everybody knows them. But because those local banks operate within a city, within a town, within a state, within the United States, those rules are a little bit more strict. And so that is hurting them. Not that, you know, rules are bad by any means. We need them in place to prevent fraud, to prevent things like that. But when you have these Wall Street banks come into a town, they do operate under a separate set of rules, being an out-of-state bank. That's why most of the time when you get a credit card, it comes from Delaware. They base everything out of a place with low regulation, and they come in, they swoop out these little local banks, you know. And so back to the main point, we've only got about a minute left here. What happens when we give the bank our money? They take that, they go put it in a CDO, a swap, a derivative, whatever those things really are. What is the overall effect when that happens?
Well, yeah, less borrowing, less economy, less economic growth. It's the banks are growing, but the communities are not. Those rules you're talking about, so people understand, is those banks have to have reserves. They have to have so much money in their deposit to lend out money. Well, that's difficult when you're competing with these big banks, and so they go in and they can't compete. And so I think right now we need to have some new regulations. The people have to stand up and protest this and say, look, we need to save our community banks. We need to have state-run banks. We need to be able to force the big banks to loan the money out rather than going for the CDOs and these buying office buildings and all the real estate investments to try to keep the small businessman alive. Because otherwise, there's no hope, because you have to have that borrowing to survive.
You know, for all the talk that we hear from politicians about the need to support small businesses and let's put money back into communities, this seems like a great way. And just overall, the theme is everyone, whether it's a big bank or a small locally owned bank, they have got to be playing by the same rules. If they're not, we end up with a situation like today where an out-of-state bank or corporation or anything can come in, knock all local businesses out of business, and that's the end. Michael, thank you so much for telling us the story today.
Thank you, Fairman.
So, Pap, we've been talking a lot about wealth inequality in this country, and I think, you know, it has become, certainly since Occupy, it has become far more in the forefront of discussion. Over the past couple of years, you know, we've had some small progressive gains. You've had about a half dozen cities have added things like paid sick leave. You know, across the country, we've got four states that are going to be voting to raise the minimum wage, Nebraska, South Dakota, Alaska, Arkansas. One thing that I saw this week that really struck me, and I think it's indicative of just how much financial insecurity there is. You know, we hear talk that supposedly the economy is rebounding, the stock market has been going gangbusters, but for the vast majority of Americans, they are not sharing in this rebounding economy. And this I found fascinating. Americans took the least amount of vacation time in almost four decades last year. They forfeited billions of dollars in compensation. And not only that, despite the fact that that Americans probably thought they were scoring points with their bosses, they didn't. Americans with paid time off used 16 of 20, almost 21 vacation days in 2013, down from an average of 20 days off from 1976 to 2000. It added that 169 million days of permanently forfeited U.S. vacation time equated to $52 billion in lost benefits. In other words, people are subsidizing their bosses because they're afraid to take time off.
Mm. Well, you know what? I got to tell you, we've been focusing on the politics kicking around. While the politics have been kicking around of midterms, the crazy stories have continued to get even crazier. You've got Politico. Now, first of all, you're just like I am, suspect as hell of Politico. I think Politico is like, you know, just this wolf in sheep's clothing is, I guess, the most best adage for them. But they come out and they let the BP executive, Jeff Morelli, to come out, who's a senior vice president of communications at BP, and he starts giving this litany of lies. Why do they do it? Because he has close personal relationship with the leadership at Politico. Now, papers all over the country have beat the hell out of Politico for this. They allowed this BP executive to use this platform to spread these incredible made-up lies about how everything is fine in the Gulf. I'm honest to God, this is what this Politico piece said. Now, why did they do that? Because he's pals. Honest to God, Jeff Morrell is pals with the people at BP. And so here's the lies. There's no danger to the sea life anymore. The ecosystem has been completely cleared up. There is no oil on the bottom of the Gulf. That is a lie. Let me go on with the other lies. Yeah, there was no impact to the ecosystem. That this case is completely being made up by greedy claimants. That BP should be given complete immunity in this because the government was responsible. Now, these are Morelli. This is what Politico, this is the type of stuff that Politico allowed to be on their pages because there's some kind of love relationship, you know, good buddy relationship between Jeff Morrell, who is the senior vice president of communications, and the folks at Politico. But here we are, we're thinking Politico is this organization that they just take it right down the middle, buddy. They just tell the truth right down. This to me is the biggest black eye for that organization. And if we'll keep talking about it, we're gonna start identifying more Politico scams. This is nothing but a friggin' scam.
Well, I gotta say that I think people online are starting to refer to them as BPolitico, as it were. But you know, I mean, it's fascinating. Also, coming out of South Florida, not only that story about BP, but in a larger picture, and this is really basically just a cry from help coming from the southern part of your state, Pap. South Miami, Florida. Held a vote, and it was, again, it's just a cry for help, but it's frankly, we're going to need to see more of this. They voted to support the secession of Southern Florida from Northern Florida because they know that the people in the state house in Tallahassee, and when you got a state controlled by a guy like Rick Scott, they know that Tallahassee is doing nothing about global climate change. And that Miami sits upon limestone, and as the sea rises, not only is the ocean going to sort of spill over onto the coast, but it's going to bubble up from the ground. And this is a cry for help that they need actually someone in Tallahassee to pay attention. And again, it's part of the broader story you're talking about. I mean, you know, we have an absence of leadership in this country. And granted, President Obama has tried and he is jammed up by the Republicans. But it is stunning that that you've got cities now having to resort to this type of thing. And, you know, part of the reason is you've got the corruption of the larger media. I mean, when BP can essentially buy their way onto
Politico,
you've got right now I'm looking at Politico. Politico's Energy Insider Tweet Hub presented by Chevron. Now, of course, we're not going to hear anything about global climate change. Of course, we're not going to hear anything about Chevron trying to buy an election out in a mayoral race out on the West Coast. We're not going to hear anything about what BP has done to the environment. This is
But the worst thing about the political story, of course, is the personal relationship. Look, talking about, we got a couple of minutes here, talking about Florida, you know, so many of the Blackwater security guards came out of kind of the special ops organizations down in Florida, you know, all around North Florida. You've got all, that's where special ops train. This jury issuing a guilty verdict for Blackwater guards, what a victory. What a victory for decency. You know, four former Blackwater security guards, they were convicted of this 2007 shooting, more than 30 or 35 Iraqis in Baghdad. And what ended up happening was then when the jury heard this, it was that they concluded that here you had these Bruce Willis types dressed up like, you know, like they're still in a real war, that just damn sure wanted to shoot somebody. They just right. damn sure wanted to kill somebody, and they found them guilty of first-degree murder because of that. And that's
I mean, it's a perfect example of the problems with hiring mercenaries, frankly. And just another attempt to in some way hide the impact of war from the American public.
That's it for this week's Ring of Fire, but you can keep up with us throughout the week online at ringoffireradio.com, on Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio, and on Facebook. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you next week right here on Ring of Fire.